Hi guys, welcome to the first video on the chapter Resource and Development. Now, we have divided this chapter into four topics. So, we'll be starting the first topic with resources. Now, what is resource? So, basically, a resource is something that we need to satisfy our day-to-day needs. So, it could be anything from an aeroplane, it could be anything from fuel I need for my car. So, that is a resource for us. Now, industry is a resource for us, food is a resource to us. So, water is a resource to me. So, anything around us that helps us satisfy our needs is a resource. And we have resources all around us. So, let us discuss the various resources that we have and how can we classify them. So, a resource is something that is available in our environment. Now, this is a very basic definition. Now, what constitutes a resource specifically is that there are three sub-conditions. And the first condition in that is that it should be technologically accessible. I can consider resource anything, but it has to be technologically accessible at that time as well. So, for example, I may consider a new iron ore found in Mars as a resource to me because I think I can use iron. But right now, we don't have the technology to actually mine the iron ore there. So we don't know how to go there, mine the iron ore. So for us right now, it is not a resource. Then second is economically feasible. So in economically feasible, first of all, everything comes down to money. So if it is not cheap enough, then it is not in our budget, then it is not a resource to us. So oil somewhere in the depths of Antarctica is still a resource. We know that it is a resource, we can use that, but to drill that oil may require trillions of dollars, and of course we do not have that much money to just drill the oil. So basically that will not be a resource to us. Then the third thing is that it should be culturally acceptable. So by culturally acceptable, I mean that, let's say meat is a food resource for me. I can eat meat. Now, that is culturally acceptable that I can eat chicken, that I can eat lamb. But it is not culturally acceptable that you eat human meat. So, in that sense, human meat is not a food resource to me. So, in this sense, culturally acceptable is the third condition, which is very important. Okay, so now let us see. How can we classify different resources? So, first of all, resources can be classified into natural, human, and human-made. So, human-made are your artificial resources. So, your natural resources, your human resources, and your artificial resources. Now, natural resources are again subdivided based on different classification. So, it can be done based on the origin of that resource, based on the utility of that resource, then based on what type of development there is, then depending on where it is distributed or who owns it. So these five subcategories decide the various classifications. Now, based on origin. So if it is originating from living matter, then it is a biotech resource. If it is originating from a non-living organism, then it is a abiotic resource. So anything from plants, animals, insects, they are your biotic resources. Anything from your minerals, your air, your water, that is non-living, so that will be your abiotic. Now, then it comes based on utility. So, depending on how we can replenish them, how quickly we can replenish them, they are divided into renewable and non-renewable. So, things that can be replenished easily. So, your water, once it is used, then again using the hydrological cycle, we'll have again water. So rivers will be flowing again. So we have renewable resource of water. On the other hand, once you used oil, once you use coal, petroleum, then it is gone. It cannot be replenished again because coal takes millions of years to form. So that makes it a non-renewable resource. Next is based on level of development. What is the development currently? So on that basis, it can be potential. Now, potential is something that we know we can use it. We know it is found there, but we have so far not used it enough. So that could be like thorium in India. We found thorium. India has plenty of thorium. We can use it, but we have not used it enough. So that it has the potential to be a resource for us in future. And then comes your developed resource. So that is all your resource around us, water, air, we know how to use them, we know what are the technologies accessible for us, and we know how to mine that resource, use it for our advantage. So that is your developed resource. Then comes your stock resource. Stock resources are those resources we have kept us in potential, we have kept it with us, but it will be used in future. So right now there is no proper technology available. So you will see that in stock resource we know it can be used later. So like we know that water has a lot of potential, that if we divide water into hydrogen and oxygen, hydrogen gas can be used for our fuel needs. But so far we don't have proper technology to explore that avenue. So water is again a stock resource for us that in future can be helpful. Then comes your reserves. So reserves are basically, we know that it is currently the technology that we have, with the current technology we can use it, but we are not using it citing future needs. So it is available and can be developed but yet to be used. So an example would be your oil and gas reserves in US. They have plenty of gas reserves, but still they import from Saudi Arabia. So that makes it a reserve for them. In future, they can use it. Now comes based on distribution, how it is distributed, whether it is distributed at a specific location or it is distributed all over the world. Like your minerals. So your minerals are formed in specific locations. Iron ore will be formed in some area in Bihar, Gujarat. You have oil there. So it is formed in specific locations. It is not formed all over the world. Whereas your water is formed all over the world. Sunlight is formed, found all over the world. So that makes it ubiquitous. So if it is localized, it will be in a specific location. If it is available all over the world, then it is ubiquitous. So this is based on your level, on your distribution. Then comes your ownership. Who owns that resource? So if a private individual owns a resource, then it comes under private individual ownership. So like this pen that I have in my hand, I own that pen, so it is an individual resource. Whereas if a community owns that, then it will be a community resource, like some parks. So these parks are owned by communities, so specific communities can use them. It does not belong to any one individual. Okay, now comes your national. So these resources which are under owned by the government of India or a government of any country for that matter, so those are called national resources, like our defense, like our Indian railways. Okay, so all of them are owned by the government. So all these resources are your coal mines, they are owned by the government. So these are your national resources. Then comes your international resources. No one specific country will own this resource. It is owned by majority of countries. 4 or 5 countries will be owning them, or all the countries could be owning them. So those will be your international resources. Example could be the ocean waters, which are open, which is not under any country's jurisdiction. Any resource found there belongs to all the countries. So this is regulated and owned by international bodies. Okay, so your EEZ area, beyond that, the resources found in the sea belong to everyone. Like your Antarctica, no country owns Antarctica, and any resource found there belongs to everyone. So it is an international resource. So this is the various classification that a resource can be done on. And this concludes our first topic. In the next topic, we'll be discussing the development of resources and resource planning. Thank you so much.